Broken heart syndrome. Is that even a real thing? In 2019, a 65-year-old Italian woman went to her local dentist to get a tooth taken out. It was supposed to be a minor oral surgery. She didn't even need to be put under, just local anesthesia around the tooth, and it just gets plucked out. No big deal, right? Except for the fact that she fainted right after the dentist numbed her up. Maybe the dentist assumed it was just because she wasn't good with needles. But it quickly became clear that something much more serious was happening because she soon went into cardiac arrest. And as EMTs frantically attempted to revive her, the most urgent questions became, what was happening to her and why? But this was no heart attack. This was something different. Harder to spot, but more difficult to diagnose, but equally as dangerous. This was a real case of broken heart syndrome. So let's break down the history of this strange medical condition that had plagued the last 7 years of this woman's life. Broken heart syndrome is a medical mystery that, let's be real, sounds kind of fake. In addition to tracing the story of our Italian dental patient, we're going to discuss how broken heart syndrome was discovered and what it looks like and who is at risk. Buckle up because this may be one of the most unusual and fascinating health conditions to be discovered in the last, you know what, let's do a pop quiz. When do you think broken heart syndrome was first discovered? Was it A, 1892, B, 1947, C, 1991, or D, 2005? If you said C or D, you'd technically be right-ish, but we'll get to that. For now, let's say that our first correct answer is D, 2005. This syndrome has only been officially recognized by the English-speaking medical establishment since 2005, the year of Hurricane Katrina, a new Catholic Pope, and the creation of this very platform, YouTube. Even though Shakespeare, Dickinson, and Billy Ray Cyrus have been harping on the pain of unrequited love for centuries, the first reported cases of medical achy breaky heart were only validated in the English-speaking world when Dr. Elon Wittstein published a paper on the condition in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2005. Of course, just like the video game consoles and public transportation, the Japanese had done it before us, and better. That's why you'd be correct if you said C. All the way back in 1991, a team of Japanese researchers published a series of papers documenting their observations of the syndrome. They discovered it. They got to name it. Which is why it's officially known as Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. Obviously, broken heart syndrome is a bit more catchy in English, but the reason for this original name is based on a cleverly hidden secret about the condition itself. Takotsubo cardiomyopathy, let's break it down. We'll start with the second word, cardiomyopathy. Now, you may have heard doctors on medical shows rattle this one off. If we break it up, cardio means heart, myo means muscle, pathy means disease. These are all from Greek roots. Doctors love Greek roots. So put them all together, and cardiomyopathy refers to a disease that affects the heart muscle and subsequently its ability to pump blood to the rest of the body. This happens when the heart muscle becomes weakened from stiffening or scarring or both. So then, what's the first word about Takotsubo? Because that's where the secret lies. Real quick, anatomy 101, your heart. It's got four chambers, divided into left and right atrium and left and right ventricles. Separating them are valves. What you need to know is that the biggest chamber, the left ventricle, is responsible for pumping oxygen-rich blood past the aortic valve, and it delivers all that blood to your organs, well, except for your lungs, because that's pumped by the right ventricle. But notice the shape of the left ventricle. What does that shape look like to you? An arrowhead? A leech? An organ used for reproduction? I don't know, but this is how it's supposed to look. Here comes your fun fact. Takotsubo in Japanese breaks down into tako meaning octopus, subo meaning pot. Huh? Takotsubo actually isn't a medical term. It's a type of pot that's used by Japanese fishermen. When Japanese doctors first observed this condition, they took one look at that left ventricle and they said, hey, that looks like one of those pots that catches octopuses. Or is it octopi? I don't know. But that's what it looks like. It causes the left ventricle to swell up like a balloon down below with a narrow neck above. Which takes us back to our 65-year-old Italian woman. How do we know that she was suffering from this? 7 years before, she'd been admitted into a hospital with symptoms of chest pain and fainting, and at that time, her echocardiogram, meaning ultrasound of the heart, revealed that her left ventricle wasn't pumping so well, and it also showed that the left ventricle was ballooning down below with a narrowed neck. Now, to compare this echocardiogram image to our heart drawing, we'll have to flip it upside down. Look at that, classic Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. She recovered fully within a couple of weeks, but a year later, she's back in the hospital with the same scans, same results, and ultimately the same recovery. And then she has a third episode, which maybe you think she's just gonna have a repeat of the same thing all over again, right? But hold on a second. Why does this happen to the left ventricle? And why did our Italian woman suffer from broken heart syndrome in the dentist's office of all places? As you might have guessed from the name, researchers originally theorized that a big emotional shock was the precursor to this condition. A lot of circumstantial evidence supported that theory. So back in 2004, for example, there was a huge earthquake that rocked central Japan. And in the months that followed, no fewer than 16 people were diagnosed with this condition. And that makes sense. A bunch of people lose their homes in a traumatic natural disaster. That's hugely stressful. Other researchers reported seeing broken heart syndrome in patients who had recently lost a loved one. Another patient was panicking because of gambling losses. Another because of the stress of their job. In fact, grief, fear, anger, and even surprise have all been reported as precipitating episodes of broken heart syndrome. So, at risk of downplaying the seriousness of this condition, I have to say, some of the triggers for broken heart syndrome are kind of wild. Which of the following is an actual reported trigger of broken heart syndrome? A. Winning the lottery. B. Unexpectedly asked to give a speech at work. C. A beloved pet labradoodle being threatened while on a walk. D. Trying to apply hair dye while camping. Your tent blowing away. Being forced to go grab the tent and re-spike it, all the while stressing out about what color your hair is going to end up since you've had the dye in your hair for too long. This is a trick question because the answer is E. All of the above. Yep. So did our Italian dental patient suffer from a recent loss? Was her heart literally broken? We don't know the cause of her first two episodes of broken heart syndrome. But in the case of her third episode, it doesn't appear to have been an emotional trigger. More recent research has revealed that statistically, physical triggers cause a higher percentage of cases than emotional ones. So a multi-year study that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine found that physical triggers like an accident, a broken bone, head trauma, major health complications like pneumonia or drug withdrawal and surgery are present in 1/3 of cases, which is about the same number for emotional triggers as the cause. Also, about 1/3 of cases have no apparent trigger at all. And this is a diagnosis that can be pretty tricky to pick up on. Chest pain, nausea, fainting. Those symptoms can occur with a much more common diagnosis, a heart attack. Myocardial infarction. But while a heart attack involves blood vessels in your heart getting blocked by plaque buildup, this is entirely different. And just as the Italian woman had done twice before when she was hospitalized for those symptoms, doctors need to image your heart by performing an echocardiogram, coronary angiography, or MRI to make the distinction. But who is actually more likely to get this syndrome? In a survey of over 1,700 patients with broken heart syndrome, nearly 90% were women. Women are 9 times more likely than men. Age is another big factor, the average age being 67. Patients with broken heart syndrome were twice as likely to have been diagnosed with a neurologic or psychiatric disorder. Yeah, over half of patients had a history of mental issues, which was what happened with this lady. At the time of her dental appointment, she was taking benzodiazepines for an anxiety disorder. But even if you fall into all of these demographics, that doesn't necessarily mean that you'll get it. So just how common is it? Well, between 2006 and 2017, there were slightly under 140,000 cases of this that were reported in the United States. That's about 13,000 cases per year. But keep in mind that increasing awareness of this condition means that the number of cases diagnosed every year is also increasing. And because broken heart syndrome is so hard to distinguish from a heart attack, a lot of these cases still go misdiagnosed, whether as it's being diagnosed as acute coronary syndrome, such as a heart attack, or sometimes it could be diagnosed as a simple panic attack. In fact, doctors think that 2% of acute coronary syndrome diagnoses may actually be broken heart syndrome. That may not sound like a lot, but with 16 million people in the US alone diagnosed with various heart conditions every year, that's an estimated 320,000 people being misdiagnosed on an annual basis. For a long time, broken heart syndrome appeared relatively benign. A large majority of patients do recover within 2 to 4 weeks, and the left ventricle goes back to its non-octopus pot shape. But what do you think the short-term mortality rate is for someone experiencing an episode of this condition? Is it A, 1 to 2%, B, 3 to 5%, C, 10%, or D, 18%? The answer is B, 3 to 5%, but C and D are relevant for us as well because while immediate death rates are under 1 in 20, wait just 1 year after an initial diagnosis of broken heart syndrome, and the mortality rates are much higher. One study found that mortality rates after a year were 10% for female patients, while men were all the way up to 18%. These are comparable to mortality rates for heart attacks. Worldwide, broken heart syndrome deaths may be as high as 40,000 per year. In this case, her third episode of broken heart syndrome, brought on by the stress of getting a minor dental surgery, led to her going into cardiac arrest, and she died not long after. An autopsy revealed that there was no coronary artery disease or valvular disease, no heart attack, but it did show extremely unusual apical ventricular ballooning. And there's your diagnosis. But how does broken heart syndrome develop in the first place? Medical theories should always start with the medical facts. We know women are 9 times more likely to get it than men, and far more likely to develop it when they're older than age 55. Around age 50, menopause hits, and the production of estrogen starts declining. Estrogen is a hormone that regulates a lot of stuff, including protecting the heart from the harmful effects of norepinephrine, aka adrenaline. When we get super stressed out, we enter this fight or flight mode and the body releases catecholamines. These hormones, epinephrine and norepinephrine, can wreak havoc on the body. Think about what would happen if you go for a walk and all of a sudden you see a huge bear walking toward you. Your fight or flight mode kicks in. Your heart is pumping harder and faster because of these hormones. And sometimes these hormones whip the heart so much it ends up overworked and it weakens. Also, anxiety and depression likely plays a role in this as well. So estrogen also influences the production of neurotransmitters like norepinephrine, serotonin, dopamine, and low levels of certain neurotransmitters are associated with depression. But there is still a lot we don't know. This research is still in its early stages. And weirdly enough, one of the drugs most often given to reduce the effects of adrenaline, that would be beta blockers like metoprolol, appears to have no effect on mortality rates when given to people with broken heart syndrome. We know that you can die of broken heart syndrome, although it's unlikely, but we still don't know quite why. But at least you now know the Japanese word for an octopus catching pop.